would you turn with me today to Genesis chapter 2? Genesis chapter 2. And if you have a marker, or if you have an extra finger, slide it in Genesis 2 and also go to 1 Corinthians chapter 7. If you didn't bring a Bible or you don't have a Bible, the scriptures will be in front of you on the screens. I'll be reading from the New Living Translation. We are in what I'm calling a PG-11, PG middle school series. Okay, so anybody who's under middle school age, you might consider whether or not you want them to be here. Now, if they were my kid, I'd just leave them. I'm not going to say anything, I don't think, today that would be offensive to anybody. But we're in the middle of a three-part series called What's Love Got to Do With It? What's Love Got to Do With It? There are things that this world associates with love, our culture associates with love, that simply does not bear up under the weight of Scripture. When you shine the light of Scripture on these issues, then they don't pass the test. Last week, we talked about pornography. We talked about the devastating effect that pornography has on our bodies, our minds, our spirits, our relationship with the Lord, and our relationships with each other. That love, we concluded last week, love has nothing to do with pornography. And pornography has nothing to do with love. Next week, we're going to talk about domestic violence and sexual abuse. And unfortunately, there are examples of that in the Word, and we'll talk about some of those as well. But today, we're going to talk about cohabitation, living together before marriage or without being married. Okay, so I'm going to read Scripture, and I'm going to pray. And if you've got little people in here and you don't want them to hear this conversation, then you can sneak them on out during the prayer. But please come back. All right. If you'll go to the lobby, then somebody will be there to meet you and to escort your kids to the kids ministry. OK, Genesis chapter 2. Let's read this. Verses 23 and 24. At last, the man exclaimed, "This one," he's talking about Eve, "this one is bone from my bone and flesh from my flesh. She will be called woman because she was taken from man." And verse 24 says, "This explains why a man leaves his father and mother and is joined to his girlfriend." Is that what it says? "This explains why a man leaves his father and mother and is joined to his wife, and the two are united into one." And 1 Corinthians chapter 7, Paul says, because there is so much sexual immorality. Does that sound like a culture that you might be aware of somewhere, like here, America? "Because there is so much sexual immorality, each man should have his own girlfriend. Each man should have his own wife, and each woman should have her own boyfriend. Each man should have his own wife, and each woman should have her own husband." Let's pray. Yes, it's going to be that way today. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. I pray that you give us courage today. God, we ask that you would give us courage to listen and obey your word. I pray, God, that there be no spirit of offense, Lord, but there will only be a spirit of excitement about receiving the word, that even if it costs us something, Lord, even if it challenges us in ways that we did not expect to be challenged at church, I pray that today, Lord, that people would not fall under condemnation, but Lord, would be convicted by your Holy Spirit and would be encouraged, God, to change and to do the right thing, because we want everything that we do and say and every way that we live to bring you honor and glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Now, first of all, please relax. Look at the person beside you and tell them to relax, please. I'm not sure that you should really say relax and then the pastor grabs a rope. So I just want to give you a quick illustration. I had a revelation this week that I need to share with you that I think is going to rock your world. It's going to change your life. Okay, this is a revelation that you probably never heard of or never thought of before. When it comes to relationships, I want to help you understand this. When it comes to relationships, men and women are different. Amen. There you go. Thank you. Fasting prayer, that does that for you. Men and women are different in relationships, in what they expect, in what they want, in what they're seeking, in what they desire. Men and women are different. They are different, not just physically, they're different in the way they think. That's a good place to say amen. Fairly safe place to say amen. Different in the way that they think. They're different in what they expect. They even look at relationships differently. Now I'm going to paint with some pretty broad strokes right now. This is a generalization, but there's a reason that things become generalizations, because there's lots and lots of evidence to prove it's right. So this is pretty general, but in general, here's what happens. So if you come into a relationship, and this rope represents a relationship. So when a man gets into a relationship, what a man is generally looking for, and I won't make you say it, but what a man is generally looking for is sex. Thank you for not saying amen there. For the awkward silence, I appreciate that. What men generally are looking for is sex. Now, that's just the first three things that he's looking for in a relationship. Okay, so ladies, on the other hand, are generally looking for intimacy. They're looking for someone to connect with, someone that they can have a relationship with, someone they can have intimacy with, that they can share the deepest, darkest secrets of their heart and in a safe place. Okay? Now, again, that's broad generalizations, but that's I think you've probably lived long enough that you can see the wisdom in that. Now, the problem is if a woman is looking for that and she goes into a relationship going in that direction, and a man is looking for sex and goes in the other direction, they're going in opposite directions. They're pulling against each other. It is not going to work, is it? Because they're going in the wrong direction. What's going to have to happen, and this is the way God designed it, what's going to happen is they're going to have to figure out a way that both ends can meet. They're going to have to figure out a way to get both of their needs met at the same time. They're both going to have to give up something in order to get what they want. That's how relationships work. And so what they really need to do is to bring this thing together. Now, what do you call what I'm doing? Tying the knot. What makes this relationship work is tying the knot. It's the commitment of marriage. Amen. That's why they call it tying the knot. It's the commitment of marriage that makes this work. Because when you're in a committed relationship, a woman does not mind giving sex in order to get intimacy. And a man does not mind giving intimacy in order to get sex. You see how both of them get what they need? They're both pulling in the same direction. The ends meet because they tie the knot. It's covenant. It's commitment. You see that? It's vows. That's where that comes from, and that's why God designed it that way. He created married people to enjoy sex, to enjoy relationships together through the covenant commitment of marriage. But if you don't have the covenant commitment of marriage, you're pulling in opposite directions. So you got to tie the knot. Amen. Let's all stand. I'm just kidding. No, we're gonna talk about the rest of the scriptures. It's your 3-minute devotion. We got to talk about the rest of scriptures, but I want you to remember this. I'm going to leave this knot here so you can be reminded of that during the message. So the question that we have to answer today is, why is cohabitation a sin? Why is cohabitation a sin? Why is living together without being married a sin? And if it's not a sin, then why are we talking about it? Why are we even spending time in church to talk about it? So again, I'm painting with broad strokes, but and I think you'll agree with me here, there are only two kinds of people who live together. People who are sleeping together and people who aren't. Because you can't kind of sleep together, right? Please relax. Two kinds of people who live together, either people who are sleeping together or people who are not sleeping together. We're going to deal with the 99% of the people who are sleeping together first. Okay? If you are living together outside of the context of marriage and you are sleeping together, then is a very clear biblical principle. It is what the Bible calls fornication. It is sexual immorality. It is having sex outside the context of marriage. The opening scripture that we read in 1 Corinthians, and I can give you probably a dozen more, and that's available upon demand if you want them, probably a dozen more show that married sex is the only kind of sex that God has ordained and the only kind that He can bless. Outside of that, outside of God's plan and will for us, is sin. And it's not, that's a pretty good definition of sin, not just in the context of sexual immorality, but in any context, anything that is outside the will and the plan of God for us is sin. Amen. So in short, When you cohabitate, when you live together, it's not just a cliche. You are literally living in sin. Because the situation that you found yourself in, well, you didn't find, it's not like you woke up and you were living together. The situation that you have created for yourself is a sinful situation. This is not a sin of passion. It's not like you just didn't know what you were doing and suddenly you were living together. You make a series of choices that lead to that lifestyle. So it's important for us to understand where you wound up, and it's important for us by the end of this message to figure out what you can do as a result of that. Okay? Now, the problem in our culture, the reason we're spending time talking about this, is that more and more and more, it is common for people to live together now. It is seen in this culture at any age, in any generation, but especially in our younger generations, it is viewed as the next logical step in the relationship. That you date, you spend time together, and eventually, sometimes sooner rather than later, you say, we're taking our relationship to the next level. We're going to move in together. Now, I've shown you why it's a sin. Now I want to show you why it's just a bad idea. It's just a bad idea. So research, Rutgers University did this research several years ago. It has only gotten worse and has only proven to be more correct over time. But according to this study, only 18% of live-in relationships last 3 years. So for those of you that are not good at math, 82% of relationships are going to break up within the first 3 years. And only 10% actually last 5 years. So this idea that you're going to get together, you're going to live together, and that it's just going to blossom and grow into a beautiful thing, that's just not backed up by the research. Cohabitation increases the risk of divorce. If you actually do make it to marriage, it increases the risk of divorce. So again, this idea that it's just a good natural progression to a healthy, strong relationship is simply a myth. It's simply a myth. Cohabitation also greatly increases the risk of domestic violence. And we'll talk more about domestic violence next week, but one of the big risk factors for domestic violence is not marriage, but living together outside of marriage. And then couples who are living together are more likely to cheat on each other, according to this research. They're more likely to cheat, and they are less likely to report sexual satisfaction than married couples. Married couples are enjoying their married sex better than live-in couples are enjoying theirs. Now, there's lots of other research out there, lots of more statistics that I could drown you with this morning, but isn't that enough? This is enough. If you want to be a follower of Jesus, living together is a sin, and it's just a bad idea. It's just a bad idea. You say, now, John, hang on, there's an exception. What about engaged couples? If we're engaged, then we clearly love each other. We clearly have a commitment to each other. So it's okay for us to go ahead and move in together, correct? Well, let me just ask you a simple question. Have you ever known engaged couples that didn't get married? Yes, you have, probably. Engaged couples break up 50% of the time. Half the engaged people that you know will never actually walk down the aisle together. And so it is a bad justification for moving in together. Just because he put a ring on it does not mean he wants to marry you. All right? All right. Y'all getting quiet on me. What about people? So what about the 1% of people who are living together but are not sleeping together? Assuming there are people like that. Everyone claims that's what's going on, but I do not believe in it. First, if that is actually true for somebody, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 22 says this, abstain from all appearance of evil. Amen. Can we agree that sex outside of marriage is sin? If you're living with someone, the assumption is you're also having sex. So it is clearly the appearance of evil. Now, let me, by way of proof, let me offer to you the announcement in the student ministry for this series. The same young lady who announced for the name of the series, which she told me the other day, remember I told you last week, she's the one that said, did you know there's a song called What's Love Got to Do With It? This same young lady made the announcement in the student ministry about cohabitation. And she said, so he's going to preach about cohabitation, which is, you know, people who are not married, who are living together, who are doing, you know, married stuff. And that's about as good a definition as I can figure out to pass on. The 16-year-olds are assuming that you're doing married stuff, whether you're married or not. It is the appearance of evil. Now, you say, well, you know what? I don't care what people think. That's their problem. That's not my problem. No, actually, for a believer, it is your problem. Ecclesiastes chapter 7 and verse 1 says, a good reputation is more valuable than costly perfume. If you are living with someone outside of marriage, then you are ruining your reputation as a believer. Now, let's look at it in Romans chapter 14. Verses 12 and 13, Paul says, yes, each of us will give a personal account to God. So first of all, you can say what you want to everybody else, but God knows what's going on in that house. Verse 13, so let's stop condemning each other. Instead, decide to live in such a way that you will not cause another believer to stumble and fall. Now look, we know, mature people know you cannot live your life to please everybody. You will never please everybody, right? But you cannot throw the concept out. You can't live to please everybody, but you also cannot live in such a way that you disregard other people's opinions of you, where you disregard the clear command of Scripture. It is an offense to unbelievers, and it's an offense to believers. It's confusing for unbelievers. If you say that you love Jesus and serve Jesus and follow Jesus, but you don't do what Jesus says to do in His Word, it is confusing and it is a stumbling block for people who are trying to come to Christ, because they think, why should I come to Christ when the people who follow Christ don't do what Jesus said? And Jesus said in Matthew that it is a very dangerous place for us to be when we cause a person to stumble or block their way trying to get to Jesus. As a matter of fact, He said it's better for you to have a millstone tied around your neck and you thrown in the middle of the sea than to cause offense for one of these little ones. It is important. It is your problem what somebody thinks of you, what somebody sees in your life. It is your problem. So living together is a sin. Whether you're sleeping together or not, it's a sin, and it's just a bad idea in general. You say, well, John, I don't understand. I mean, what's the big deal about a wedding? A wedding is just a ceremony. It's just a useless ceremony. Marriage is just a piece of paper. I mean, how does this change anything? I want to show you what the Word says about weddings so that you understand this is not just a useless, archaic ceremony that results in a piece of paper. I want you to see what the wedding proves and what it shows. So we're going to go to Song of Solomon, chapter 3. Now, for those of you who are familiar with Song of Solomon, y'all calm down. We're not reading everything. We're only reading the passage about Solomon's wedding to the Shulamite girl. All right, verse 7, Song of Solomon, chapter 3. Verses 7 and 8, look, it is Solomon's carriage surrounded by 60 heroic men, the best of Israel's soldiers. They are all skilled swordsmen, experienced warriors. Each wears a sword on his thigh, ready to defend the king against an attack in the night. So the first thing that a wedding does, it is a promise of protection. A wedding is a promise of protection. When you take a wife, now understand, this is Solomon's carriage, but look at it, it is protected by Solomon's detail. This is the secret service for the king of Israel. These are the baddest of the bad. These are the most highly trained and skilled soldiers in the land. He takes 60 people, surrounds that carriage. Now you say, well, what does that have to do with his wedding? That's Solomon's carriage, but it ain't Solomon riding in it. It's his bride riding in the carriage. This is the wedding processional. He's bringing her in to the wedding. And then she is being carried in his carriage, surrounded by black ops soldiers. I mean, this is a SEAL team surrounding this carriage. It is a clear promise of protection. When you take a wife, you are promising, and we'll look at this in a minute in Scripture, but you are promising to love that woman as Christ loved the church and gave Himself for the church. If you aren't willing to lay your life down for her, then you don't deserve her. A wedding declares to the world that you are promising to protect your wife and your future family. Protector and provider are two of the main roles that a godly husband has. And it starts at the wedding. It starts at the wedding. You are declaring in that ceremony, if you mess with her, you're messing with me. You say, well, John, that's awfully macho and chauvinistic of you, and it's 2017. And look, you can call it what you want to call it, but that's what God has called us to do as a husband. So if you have a problem with that, you can argue with God about it, but that's what he called us to do. There is a promise of protection that is embedded in the wedding ceremony. And it's not just a physical promise either. It's not just about protecting her physically. You protect her emotionally, and you protect her spiritually, and you protect her every way that a woman needs to be protected. Look, you don't have to be built like a WWE wrestler to be a real man. Amen. Can some of us little scrawny people say amen? It just takes somebody who's willing to stand up in public and say, I promise to protect that woman with every breath that's in me. And isn't that what Jesus called us to do? And isn't that what Jesus did for us? Now look, it don't matter how long it takes. It doesn't matter how long it takes for that person to get through you to get to her. That's 7 seconds that he slowed down while he was going through you. But you do what you have to do to lay your life down for your wife. And that's what Jesus did for us. Look at Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 25. For husbands, this means love your wives just as Christ loved the church. He gave up his life for her. He gave up his life for her. Men are to love their wives as Christ loved the church. Well, how did he love the church? He gave himself for the church. You say, why in the world would I take care of a woman like that? She's grown. She can take care of herself. Why would I do that? Because she's part of you. From the very first married couple, Adam and Eve, that she was part of him. The wife is part of the husband. Look at Genesis chapter 2 again. At last, Adam exclaimed, this one is bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. She'll be called woman because she was taken from man. And this explains, King James says, for this cause, a man leaves his father and mother and is joined to his wife, and the two are united into one. She came from man. She is part of man. And when you look at the 24th verse, it says, this explains why a man would leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, not his girlfriend, not move in with her, but be joined to her as a wife. When you take the vows of marriage in your wedding and you consummate that union on your wedding night, then you become one flesh. Physically, spiritually, every way you can. You are one flesh. So what's best for you is to take care of your wife. If you want what's best for you, you take care of your wife. Let me show it to you. Three verses over in Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 28. In the same way, husbands ought to love their wives as they love their own bodies. For a man who loves his wife actually shows love for himself. Now, this seems really, really crazy, but this is just the way God arranged it. Being selfless towards your wife is the most selfish thing you can do. It is the best for you to lay your life down for your wife. Isn't that strange? But he said, if you love your wife the way you love yourself, then when you lay yourself down, it's like loving her is like loving yourself. You didn't know it was in the Bible, but there it is. Happy wife. Happy life. It's right there. How else does God love the church? Well, didn't he give us his name? Doesn't he call us by his name? We are Christians. We are Christ-like or little Christ. That's how we know him, is because we carry his name. Listen, if that man will not give you his name, then how can you believe he'll ever lay his life down for you? If he wants to live with you as his wife, but is not willing to offer you his name, not willing to offer you in public the promise of protection, then you shouldn't assume he's going to do that. Standing up before God and those witnesses is a promise of protection. Here's the second thing in the wedding ceremony. In the next verse is Song of Solomon, chapter 3, verses 9 and 10. King Solomon's carriage is built of wood imported from Lebanon. Its posts are silver, its canopy gold, its cushions are purple. It was decorated with love by the young women of Jerusalem. The second thing about a wedding is a promise of protection. It's also a promise of provision. It's a promise of provision. That is a swanky ride right there. Did you see that? Post of silver covered with gold, cushions of purple. It's surrounded by 60 guys. I mean, this is the lap of luxury. This is provision. Now, not everybody is a king. Not everybody has these people. Not everybody has gold to spare. I understand that. But when what you're promising that wife, men, is when you take those vows, you're saying, everything I have is yours. Both pennies that I've got, you're feel free to rub them together anytime you want to. But everything I have, what's mine is yours, what's yours is yours, what's ours is yours, it's all yours. It might be a lot or a little, but you're promising it's all yours. And what you're saying is everything that you need, if you're married to me, everything you need, I'm going to find a way to provide for you, no matter what the cost is to myself. Some of you are all like, did I really say that in my wedding? That's what you meant. That's what she heard. I don't know what you said, but that's what she heard. Listen, that's why potential husbands should ask fathers for their blessing before they marry their daughters. And that's why fathers should not give their blessing if the boy can't work or won't work. Amen. If he can't provide. Look, ladies, do not marry a lazy man. Just don't do it. Look, Nancy Reagan was right. Just say no. Do not marry a lazy man. If he will not get his tail out of the bed and go to work, don't lay beside him. That's for sure. Don't marry a lazy man. I said can't work. I'm not implying a disability. I'm talking about a person who just refuses to work. And y'all know people like that. Amen. You don't want to say it, but you know people like that. It's a promise. That wedding is a promise of provision. Here's the third thing. Song of Solomon chapter 3 verse 11. The first part of the verse says, come out to see King Solomon, young women of Jerusalem. The third thing about a wedding is it is a public promise. It's a public promise. You know, silent praise is worthless. Silent praise is worthless. Praise, in order for it to be effective, worship, in order for it to be effective, has to be expressed. If it's silent, it's worthless. Commitment, by the same token, commitment is not a commitment if it's not public. Amen. If nobody knows you made a commitment, it ain't a commitment. It might have been a decision, it might have been a resolution, it might have been a goal, but it is not a commitment until it's spoken out loud. You say, well, she and I committed to each other that we're going to be in. No, the two of you can change your mind whenever you want to. A commitment is not a commitment if you're the only one who knows about it. The wedding is a public profession. It is a public promise of commitment. And in a wedding ceremony, God is the third party. God is the witness. God is the eternal witness to the covenant of marriage. You make those vows before God. The two of you may change your mind, but God isn't changing His mind. Amen. Amen. There are also witnesses who are there. And there can be no denying that this man or this woman is off the market. That's what that verse says. Young women of Jerusalem, come and check this out. Solomon is now off the market. The Shulamite woman has captured his heart. He is spoken for. That's what your wedding says. I'm spoken for. This guy, this girl, you can delete their contact out of your phone because they are no longer available. If you're just living together, there's no public declaration of monogamy. There's no assumption that you're together and only together. And there's no ring on that finger that lets people know that you're taken. That's what this is about. It's important that there is a public promise before God and the witnesses that you are forsaking all others and keeping yourself only unto that person until death separates you. Now here's the last thing. What in the world does a wedding mean? It's a promise of protection. It's a promise of provision. It's a public promise. And the last thing is, it's a chance for parental approval. It's a chance for parental approval. The last half of verse 11, after it says, hey, ladies, come on out and see Solomon is off the market, it says he wears the crown his mother gave him on his wedding day, his most joyous day. Do you see how family is involved in the wedding? Do you see how important it is for the family to give their blessing? The concept of blessing is one that's foreign to a whole lot of people. It's almost dead even in the church. But the concept of blessing people, offering your blessing to someone, is a very, very biblical and applicable principle in the Word. It's important for us to offer our blessing. It's important. A wedding is an opportunity for the families to come together and offer their blessing. They bless the new couple. That's why the father or some other significant person walks the bride down the aisle and gives her away. You know, well, I'm nobody's possession. You can't give me away. I'll give myself away. You know, you've heard all the attitude about that. This is not about possession. It's about blessing. It's somebody that you care about that is adding their blessing to your decision. And listen, if there are people close to you, significant in your life, that have significant concerns about the person that you chose, you need to slow down. Amen. And you need to pray about it, think about it, spend some time before you stand up there and say, I do. This is about the family saying, he made a choice, she made a choice, and we're adding our blessing to it. The two become son-in-law and daughter-in-law. That means in the eyes of the law, legally, that husband and that wife are now just as much a part of the other person's family as they are their own. The two families blend together as a support system, but the husband and the wife leave. And as the Old Test, as the old script, the King James says, they leave and cleave. They leave the mother and father and their other family, and they come together. They leave their old families to begin a new one. See, living together only starts a household. Amen. Marriage starts a family that's blessed by God and by their friends and by their families. So, well, John, what do we do? Because I'm already living together. What do we do? I'll tell you about that in a second. Let me express this, because I want you to understand. I hope every message that you ever hear me preach, it answers the question of what do we do now? Because otherwise it's just knowledge, but knowledge that is not applied is useless. So hearing the Word of God, you've got to ask yourself, what now? What do I do? Well, let me speak to the people who are not married and who are not living together. Don't consider it as an option. Just take it off the table. It is not the next step in your relationship. Don't even think about it. Listen, if you don't know them well enough to marry them, then don't move in with them. It is okay for you to date more than you know, twice before you get married. Spend enough time with them so that the real person gets revealed. Valerie and I dated for 5 years. Five years. It's a long, stinking time to date. Amen, her daddy said. He prayed for, you know, 4.5 years. In the last 6 months, he said, okay, I guess he's staying. It's important to know the person. You don't have to date them 5 years, but it's important to know the person that you're marrying, because the whole dating process is designed to hide flaws and to present your best foot. If you don't like them when you're dating them, you'll hate them when you marry them. Can somebody besides Chris say amen so Missy don't kill him? It's the truth, and you know it's the truth. So if you're not married and you're not living together, just don't. Just don't. If you are living together, I want you to hear this. Just because you're living with somebody right now does not mean you have to marry him. So you need to think about it. You need to pray about it. It's a huge commitment. It does not need to be rushed into. So here are three God-honoring options for you if you are living together. Now, John, why are you spending all this time? Because the math says that there are people in this congregation who are living together. And it's important for us to address it biblically, not condemn it, not point our fingers and shake our heads, but to say, this is what thus saith the Lord. So here's some God-honoring options. First of all, if you already know you want to get married, and I've heard this from a bunch of couples that, yeah, we meant to get married like, you know, 4 years ago. If you know you want to get married, then get married. I will help you. I will do your ceremony for free. Did I really just say that? I did. I will do your ceremony for free. We will figure this out. Come to me. We will do premarital counseling. We've been living together for 18 years. I don't care. We're going to do premarital counseling. And then we'll get together and we'll set up a date, and we can do it after a Sunday morning service. Doesn't matter to me. We'll figure it out. But if you already know you want to get married, y'all have made this commitment to each other, and you just want to make it right, then let's get it right. If you know you don't want to marry that person, then set them free and quit playing with them. You are using that person for your own purposes. This will be harsh, but in my mind, it's no better than pornography. You are using that person for your own needs. Set them free. And thirdly, if you don't know, you're living together, but you don't know if you want to get married, then move out till you decide. Just move out till you decide. Here's why. Because continuing to have sex is just going to complicate things. It's going to cloud your judgment. Separate for a time. You say, well, I can't afford that. You got a friend you can go stay with for a little while. You've got a family member. So if you don't have a friend or a family member to stay with, then let me know and we'll see if we can't come up with something. But you've got to separate. Spend some time away so you can make a good decision. It will be time well spent. You may get out of that house and go, I don't even miss the sorry thing. Then you got your answer. Right? Y'all look at me like I've lost my mind. I promise you, you got to spend some time away so that you can know what your decision is. You'll either come away from it convinced that you're marrying the right person, or you'll come away knowing that all you've got is a roommate, not a spouse. And that's an important distinction. Why don't you stand with me this morning, please? We are going to pray. We're going to pray for those who are struggling with the decision of whether to move in or not. There's a lot of times great pressure on you, especially from our culture, to move in. I want to pray that you be strong to say no and to do the right thing. If you are already living together, I want to pray that you make the right decision the right way, in a God-honoring way, and that you come out with the right conclusion. Because this is a serious, serious matter in your life. And I'm going to pray for you that you have courage and strength to make the right decision. Okay? Now don't go anywhere. I got two things to pray about before we go home. But let's pray about this, right? This response to the word right now. Would you bow your heads with me, Father, in the name of Jesus? I pray that you would, as you search our hearts, God, I pray that you would show us the areas of our lives where we're not measuring up. God, I pray for our married people. I pray, God, that you would remind me and Valerie, that you would remind every married person of what we were really saying when we took our vows. Remind us of the promise. Remind us to renew and refresh and to recommit ourselves. In those moments of weakness, in those times when it gets tough, Lord, help us to remind ourselves what we said to each other before you. Lord, I pray for every marriage in this place, God, that there are marriages that are on the rocks, marriages that are going through a difficult time. God, I pray that you'd get them on solid footing. They'd have a solid marriage. Lord, for those marriages that are already solid, I pray that they have good marriages. For every good marriage, God, I pray that they move to a great marriage. And Lord, for every great marriage, I pray that they would just continue to push forward and push ahead, that their marriage would get even greater and greater as the days go by. Lord, for those who are living together right now, I pray that you would give them the courage and the strength to make the right decision. God, not a flippant decision, not a rushed decision, but Lord, may they contemplate exactly what they need to do, and may they make the right decision to either separate and go their different ways, God, or to come together as husband and wife. Those who need to move out for a period of time, I pray that you provide a way. Provide a way, Lord. Open up a door for a friend or a family member that they can go stay. Lord, if they have to go and crash on a couch, Lord, just open that door, because it'll be time well spent in order to come up with a God-honoring solution. Lord, we just thank you for your grace. I thank you that there's grace in this church, Lord, that we're not going to judge anybody, we're not going to put anybody down, but we're going to encourage people to do the right thing. And God, I pray that you would help them to make the right decision. In the name of Jesus, we pray.